hopes about, take another route in the house of the Lord.
Dear friend, right now, reject the Savior no more. Just turn your steps about, take another route to the house of the Lord. I'd sing, I'd pray, I'd lean upon His true word. I'd sing and testify of my home on high in the house of the Lord.
If I once knew the Lord, loved His holy word, but I serve Him no more, I'd make my vows anew, ere to Him be true in the house of the Lord.
Friend, right now, reject the Savior no more. Just turn your steps about, take another route to the house of the Lord. I sing. That he's ever done that wasn't good, and so you know we want to make that statement this morning and get it out there.
maybe explain to you what he is to me and what he can be for you. Maybe he's already like that for you. We'll give him praise this morning. He's deserving of it. He deserves all glory and honor. And you know what? We're going to do our best to give that to him because he is that one that's almighty, that amazing God that's able to reach down even in our troubles and trials where we don't see a way out or a way that maybe we can get a little further down the road. But God's got the ability to reach down and give us a little good in a world maybe that's dismal and without. So, you know, as I was thinking about that, though, and maybe how he is good, and you know what, and I constantly, and I think that a Christian today, one that's been born again, saved by the grace of God through the blood of Jesus Christ, I think that we are to constantly think of ways and try to find ourselves to get into the center of God's will enough to where we can begin to figure out maybe what we can do to please God. You know, I oftentimes want to try to pay back God, but you know, I don't have the ability to do that. I can't begin to pay God back for what he's done for me. You know, it's too much. And you know, there ain't but so much I can do, and I've realized that throughout life. And there's been times I've wanted to do more than what I could, and only to realize that I'm not. And you know, I believe that there's another thing that God has begun to see in place in our life that we can see is that we are limited on the things that we can do. But you know, there's also a promise given in the Word of God, and you know, and I think we probably made mention of it, but I'm gonna make mention of it again. But it's with men, things seem impossible. With God, all things are possible. And you know what? So knowing at the same time that God has allowed us the ability to see that we only have a limited reach, that some things may be impossible to us, he also reveals himself as being the one that can make the impossible possible. So, you know, I'm thinking about the creation of God, thinking about where it all started out. And you know what? Part of that creation, and we think about the heavens and the earth and every living thing that's ever been placed upon the earth, God done all that. But you know what? The most significant thing that he done in his creation, you know what I say? It is the most significant because it not only was talked about in the first chapter, it was also explained in great detail in the second chapter, was the creation of mankind. And you know what? He thought so much about mankind. And you know what, and dwelled on it so much. You know what, he said, let us make man in our image. And you know what, as he began to say that, you know what, it was in the likeness of God that man was created. And you know what, and I want to kind of maybe drill down into that today. You know what, how God had essentially made man of his own DNA. He had come up, and you want to see what God looks like, look at yourself in the mirror. We were made in the express image of God. And you know what, ain't no two ways about it. That's the way that we were made. And you know what? So I'm going to tell you about thinking about the creation today. And you know what? And I'm going to tell you, I've seen a lot of beautiful things out in nature, and I love to get outdoors and go fishing and hunting, and I see so many amazing things. But to look up today and to see what God's done for me, you know what? All those beautiful and amazing things that he done so much for me, and that begins to allow me to realize that I'm special to God. And you know what? He looks at me, and the Bible says that because I've been born again, saved by the grace of God through the blood of Jesus Christ, that that now I am an heir. I am a son of God. And you know what? So I'm going to tell you, that's a special thing. But you know, I was thinking this past week as we was going once again, and you know what? I'm going to get in maybe to what our title, our message is here in a little bit. But I'm thinking about how many times in my life that I have been compared to my father. You know what? My daddy, you know, growing up, you know what? He just like any other daddy. I mean, my daddy was around, and you know what? He taught me things, and I was very fortunate to have that. And you know, and as I grow older, I begin to realize, and I don't know what people mean by when they say it, but you know, they say sometimes that you look just like Dennis Weston, you act just like Dennis Weston. Now, you know what? I get called out all the time because maybe the look on my face, and you know what? And they say, why are you so mad for it? And I said, well, that's the way I've looked for 30 years, but you know, that's just how it is. But they tell me that that's the Dennis Weston look. So, you know what? I guess you could say this morning that sometimes the way that I act, and as the old saying goes, that I might be a chip off the old block. And you know what? So that got me to thinking this morning, and you know, maybe on the thought that we've got about being a chip off the old block. And you know what? We may pick up those traits from our parents, and maybe act like them every now and then, and we can't help but do that because that's how our raising is. But you know what? I want you to think about that this morning. I want you to think about what it means to be called a chip off the old block. If it means to be called because you may act like your father, You know what? I believe that this morning the Scripture tells us, and very clearly, that we are supposed to act like our Father. You know what? As I begin to see right there in the creation, is that God thought enough of mankind that He created him in His own image. And you know, as He created a man in His own image, He expected man to be as Him. He expected man to act like Him and to love the things that He loved and to begin to do the things that He loved for them to do. You know, and I'm thinking this morning as I begin to get into this a little bit deeper, you know what? Not only did He expect it out of us, I believe He also demands it. But you know what? As I begin to lay hold about maybe what we're going to talk about being a chip off the old block, you know what? I believe that there's one thing that we need to realize as God's people today is the work that we do needs to be as His work it was. You know what? Whenever God rested on that last day, and you know what it said that He looked out, and you know what He observed all of the creation that He made, everything that He had His hand in, everything that took place, all the things that were made by His hands, and it said that He looked out and seen that it was all good. You know what? Everything that God done. You know what? I'm gonna tell you. I'm a firm believer in that. When creation was done, it was setting up of a standard that God would always have because He changes not. So you know, as He set the standard that day, all that standard was good. So you know, if we are going to be today as God, as He expects us to be, then the things that we do need to be good. And you know what? And I'm going to tell you, you're already thinking this morning probably, well, there's a lot that I've done that's just not good. Well, so have I. There have been a lot of things that I've done that have just not been good. But, you know, at the same time, though, that's still not an excuse for us. That's not something that we stop and we just let go of everything because we've done bad, because there's been things that have happened and we failed and come short. It doesn't make us any less. You know what? It allows us to realize even more how good God is. It's because not only do we do bad sometimes, but when we do bad, God has provided a way through His Son, Jesus Christ, and that we have that advocate with the Father. We go to Him and we repent of the things that we've done. That's how good God is. So you know, I'm going to tell you right, what this means right now is that when we repent, we are to allow ourselves to walk in the likeness of Him. Be ye holy for I am holy. A way of holiness needs to take place in our life. It needs to be what we are about. When you've been saved, you need to live like you're saved. Whenever you've been born again, you know what? You have that new illuminated look and outlook on life, and you go about doing things in a different way, and I believe that a man, he's going to show a change. There's a necessity in a man's life for him to show change in the things that he does. So we need to do good work. And you know what? It's not only that though, that we do anything less than good, it's not acceptable to God. You know what? I made the statement earlier that maybe we've done wrong before. Well, you know what? Just because we've done wrong, but just because we're a born again child of God, does not make those things okay. We still need to repent. But at the same time, we need to realize that when we repent of those things, don't do them no more. Don't go back into the same old works. We're to do good works. We're to lead after what our Father has done. His purpose from the very beginning. The very beginning of the creation, He created all the world, the heaven and the earth, and everything was good in His sight. And that first creation that He created, whenever He created man, it was even good that He made man. But you know what? As man sinned and he went about, and you know what? He got further and further away from God. God was not happy with that, and therefore He separated. But you know what? Now we see a new creation today. Now we see a man that once he has been broken down, come with a broken heart and a contrite spirit, and calls out to an almighty God that through His Son Jesus, that he be saved today. Now we see a new creation that God has created once again. It becomes a new creature in Christ Jesus. And that new creature today, just as it was in the very beginning, is good to God. It was what He made. It was by His own craftsmanship. Not anything that I've done, but it's what He done. So you know, as I know that today, as I know that I am that new creature today, that I'm supposed to produce good works just as God had in the beginning. You know what? God's always been a working God, and every work that He done was good. So you know what? You and I need to be working today and producing good works. So, you know what, we're going to get into some scripture right here. Maybe talk about maybe some people that were very instrumental in a very important phase, maybe in the Israelites. And you know what, and I begin to think about craftsmanship, and you know what, I begin to think about these men right here. Maybe not that we talk about them all the time, but you know, I want to point out something very specific about them this morning. Mostly that how God's good work was done in them. And you know, when I think you and I maybe can realize this morning what we could be doing, and how much detail we need to place in what we do for God. You know what, I'm going to tell you, I believe that details everything. You know what, if we as Christian people do not live by the details in our life, by the details that are illustrated in the Word of God, you know what, we wouldn't be much different from the rest of the world. Than what we're trying to place ourselves away from. You know what? When the Lord came into my life and He saved my soul when I was a 7-year-old boy, He gave me exactly what I needed to please God. You know, that Spirit came and dwelled within me, and when it dwells within me, you know what? I can go to the Word of God and I can begin to read it and search it out and do all things in that way. And as I seek after truth, it shows me how I can detail my life to be pleasing unto God. So, I'm going to tell you today that I think a lot of people have the misconception of thinking that once you've been saved, you know what, in a glorious thing, not taking anything away from it. It was a full work. I believe Jesus done all of it. But once you've been saved, you just sit back and wait. And that's not what God said. You know what, you don't find it anywhere in the Word of God. Once you've been saved, you know what, it's time to get out. And I'm going to refer to maybe a scripture that I think a lot of people take wrong and don't realize the full magnitude of it. But you know what, it says to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. You know, a lot of people take that and think, well, that's on the altar. You know what, to go down, and I know that it's a fearful time. You know what, when you realize that you're lost and undone and out in the world, and you don't know God, you're alienated away from Him. You know what, it's a fearful time. That's why you must come with a broken heart, a contrite spirit. Bitter tears are wept. You know what, that things like that happen. Fear and trembling is there. But you know what, I want to maybe show something to you today, and you know, maybe you can see it the way that I see it, and I think that's the way the word will be interpreted like this, but you know what? When working out your own salvation with fear and trembling, once you're saved that night and you're given a breath in your body to live on past that, God's got to work for you. And you know what? Working out our salvation, you know what? There's not a work that you can do to be saved today. There ain't enough, you can't do enough good deeds in this life in order to be saved. You must come that name of Jesus, and you must come down a broken heart and contrite spirit, calling out to Him, repenting of your sins. And it's not any work that you can do, but you know what, once a man truly has been saved though, by that salvation comes works of salvation. You know what, fear and trembling today, what does the Bible tell us? It tells us that we are to fear God. And you know what, not with a paranoia fear we see in this life, but with a reverent fear, and one that we would see, look to an almighty Father. And you know what, talking about being a chip off the old block, you know what, I knew when I was growing up, and you know what, and another fortunate thing right here, I knew whenever I done wrong, when I got out of line, you know what, my Father was going to correct me. You know what, He was going to bring discipline. And by discipline, we learn as Christian people to grow into a more routine basis of pleasing God. And you know what, as I was growing up, as I got them whoopings, I didn't like them. Still don't like them today. I don't like to do it to my kids. But you know what? At the same time, we learn. We learn to discipline ourselves to stay away from the things that are not good. And you know what? By doing so, we please our Father. So you know what I'm going to tell you? What we see right here is that God loves us enough that we work out our own salvation with fear and trembling in each and everything that we do, paying attention to the detail. Because I'm going to tell you this morning, God has gave you the ability to have that in your life. He has given you the ability to pay attention, to look to it. If you've been saved by the grace of God through the blood of Jesus Christ, you've got to know right now that Spirit that dwells within you is a spirit of perfectness. It's a spirit that will walk out of the ways of God. It will not fail you. And the only thing that fails is when we tend to get away from it and go in our own ways. But you know what? When the Spirit of God is laid upon you, you know what? It's done exactly the way of God. And I want you to see the evidence that we've got right here this morning. Maybe over in Exodus, the 31st chapter, we're going to begin to talk about some men that were anointed of the Spirit of God to carry out the building of maybe the furniture in the tabernacle. And you know what? I'm going to tell you that the tabernacle was setting up. And you know what? You go back. Look, Exodus is a filled from cover from front to back of all of the pictures of a redemption story. It filled up. It starts out with whenever the Israelites were in Egypt, and you know, time had passed. You know what? It came into a point in time to where now the Israelites were in captivity, and you know what? The story goes on, and the Lord sends Moses down, and Moses begins to bring them out, and they go out and all these things. But it comes a point in time, though. In the 31st chapter, to where there needs to be a building of certain things to lay out in a tabernacle where God can dwell. And you know what? The whole setting up of the tabernacle, I believe, is the blueprints of Jesus Christ. I believe it's the blueprints of what it's of the coming of Him, and what He'll be setting up, and what He's there for, and that sacrifice that can be made, and all those things. But we're going to pick out a specific part right here. You know, or maybe the choosing of the workers. Choosing of the ones that would do the workmanship, that would do the detail that were in the tabernacle. Now, you know what? I want to liken them unto us today as we get in a little bit deeper. But you know what? The 31st chapter of the book of Exodus, first verse. It says, "The Lord spake unto Moses, saying, See, I have called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, and the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah. And I have filled him with the Spirit of God, in wisdom, and in understanding, and in knowledge, and in all manner of workmanship, to devise cunning works, to work in gold, and in silver, and in brass, and in cutting of stones, to set them, and in carvings of timber, to work in all manner of workmanship. And behold, I have given him Beholiab, the son of Azimath, of the tribe of Dan. In the hearts of all that are wise hearted, I have put wisdom, and they may make all that I have commanded thee." You know what I'm going to tell you? This is what Moses has always been. And I was talking with my dad earlier today, and you know what? We was discussing this right here. But Moses, he was the one that would receive from God. You know, a lot, we watch our cartoons, maybe of the story of Moses and things like that. You see Moses speaking to Pharaoh. Well, that wasn't what happened. You know what? God spoke to Moses, and he gave him a mouthpiece, and his brother Aaron. Aaron spoke to him. You know what? Moses relayed the message, and Moses was given to it by God. And you know what? So the Lord is speaking to Moses right here and telling him what is going to happen. Not only telling him what's going to happen, but he's already working on it. You know, that's what I've got to be able to realize myself as a Christian, is that when God tells me to do something, when He relays the message to me, we got to already know that He's working in it. We already got to know that He's already made plans and preparation for it. You know what? God doesn't send us out to do something that He's not sure of, that He's not going to carry out. You know what? So we'll realize that this morning. Maybe just a little side note there. But you know what? As He calls Bezalel, and that this Bezalel right here, you know, not a very talked about man, but he was the one that was chosen to build this mighty workmanship that he was going to. He was going to be the craftsman of all the things that were going to be placed within the tabernacle. You know what? And how mighty of a thing that is, because you know, this is a God that's a perfect God, one that does not tolerate imperfections. He does not tolerate things that are not done right. You know what? When I think about that, I'm looking back in my life and how many times that I've messed up. How many times have I got away from it? Well, once again, God does not tolerate that. He's not okay with it. He's not just going to overlook it. You know what? Imperfections are to be ironed out. And they're ironed out by a repentant prayer, calling out to the Lord and beginning to talk it over with Him. But you know what? I want you to notice what He said right here, though. This Bezalel right here, no doubt, was a man. No doubt he was probably full of imperfections. And I'm going to tell you what I believe. I believe that he was already a craftsman. I believe he already done this work right here. But this is what God did. He took a man that maybe knew the craft already, but made him a more perfect being. And I want to tell you right now that I believe God made man in the very beginning. He created you in your mother's womb. Whenever you came out and whenever you began to walk through life, you know what? You failed to come short many a time, but you were still a creation of God. But he took something, though, you've been born again, saved by the grace of God, and placed it within you to make you a more perfect man. You know what? Don't take that lightly today. Take it for what it is, because God has placed it within your life to add detail to you where you can serve Him in all good works. You know what? We're looking at trying to be like God, trying to be like a chip off the old block right here. How we can please God, how we can do the things that are good in His sight. Well, Bezalel, you know what? He was the one right here. He said he was the son of Uri and the son of Hur and the tribe of Judah. And he says, I have filled him with the Spirit of God. I gave him the most precious thing that men looked for in that day. I'm going to tell you, there was men that it was placed upon. They had an anointing from time to time, and we know how things went. And you know what? It was a special thing to have the anointing of God. But you know what? Not only did he anoint him here, he poured it into him. And I want you to realize what this means right here. When he poured it into him, he entrusted him with the most special thing that was taking place at this moment. You know what? I'm going to tell you why this is so special. God created all men. And at this point in time, you know what? I believe. Now, you know what? You can disagree with me all you want to on this. That's fine. But you know what? Up until a certain point, all men were in agreement that there was a God who created everything. There was none that didn't believe. But you know what? As time went on, they moved further and further away from God. There was a branching out. You know what? Then time began to slip away from a lot of people. They began to go after false gods and forget the God they came from. But the Israelite people, the one that were God's chosen people of the seed of Abraham, we see right here, these are not the same people. They're different people. So it's been set up right here. This tabernacle was to be built, and it was to be built for a specific reason. And that was for the keeping of the Sabbath. You know what I'm going to tell you now? As I'm getting into this right here, you know what? There was to be a separation. Everything we see that God is trying to do and why He's giving instruction to Moses is making sure that they are a separate people. We're not of the world. We're sons of God. We're supposed to be in the likeness of Him. And so therefore, when He put His Spirit within this man to make this furniture right here, it was to be for a special occasion to get them to the point to realize that God does not accept imperfect things. He does not accept second rate. He ought to take first rate every time. But I'm going to tell you what, so many people think they can get away with just doing those things. But whenever He filled him with the Spirit of God, He made sure this man could walk in a perfect way in every little cut that he made, every little grind that he had on those pieces of furniture that were made and set up in the tabernacle. He made sure that it was guided by His Spirit, that there was no error to it. And it's the same way for you and I today. If we want to be like God, if we want to walk holy because He's holy, we've got to trust that the Spirit's going to guide us in every direction that we go and not stray away from it. Hold on to it. I'm asking you this morning, not just get a little bit, I'm asking you to be filled up. The Scripture tells us to be filled with the Spirit, not have anything else about us. You know what? That's why the Bible instructs us to be sober in everything that we do, because if we're sober, we're emptied out of the world that God may fill us up with the Spirit, that every craftsmanship that we have today can be of Him. It can be good work, something that He can be proud of, something He can look down, and I'm going to tell you, there was only one man ever heard this, and but you know what? We're going to spend a lifetime trying to get to that point to where we can hear it. He said, this is my beloved Son, who I am well pleased. You know, one day after a while, you know what? I might not hear in this walk of life, but I believe whenever the Lord comes back, takes us on home, when we enter in, He's going to say, enter in, thou good and faithful servant. You know what? That's what we're looking forward to, and you know what? It'll be because that craftsmanship by the Holy Spirit was there. That we make all things. You know what I'm trying to draw a line to here is, you know what we said, the tabernacle. tabernacle was the blueprint of Jesus Christ. It was a blueprint setting it up. You know what I'm going to tell you? When he came, he bled, he died. We accept him as our personal Savior. And he is the only begotten Son of God. We believe those things. And that today, not that we live, but he lives in us. And you know what? So when we are doing things today and claiming to be of Christ, we've got to make sure that we do things in the Spirit in his name that makes sure that all things are good. You know what? God's not pleased with anything less than be of his Son, because his Son's the only one that ever kept everything. You know what? Why are we to go out and do things in the name of Jesus? You know what? Because God is going to only accept those good things that are of him, those things that came of the perfect sacrifice, the one that was placed. You know what? I'm going to tell you, when he said, "This is my beloved Son, whom I am well pleased," you know what? That's a high compliment. That's something that God put into utmost trust in him. And you know what? It'd be wise for a man to trust in him today and begin to follow after him, because in those things, God finds good sight. Well, I'm going to tell you, you know what we begin to see here? You know what? As Bezalel went down, he had a little help. And you know what? And I believe they done everything they needed to do, because it says, "In the hearts of all that are wise hearted, I have put my wisdom." And you know what? They trusted that this man was anointed of God. And you know what? They followed after him. And created a perfect thing in God's sight, that he can come down and he can dwell in a perfect place. But you know what? I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, well, hey, a man that's perfect today, you know, how hard is that? How hard is it for us to go about the way that we know that we are sometimes? I know that I'm hard-headed. I know that there's some things that I need to get better at. But you know what? I'm going to tell you today, when God once again calls you to do something, he's already got it planned out. He's already got it ready for you. When he calls you to do something, you know, it's because he already knows that you can. When he calls you to do something, it's because that he already knows that he's already equipped you with what you need to get through it. You know what? So I'm looking at that and listening to it, because I know that's in the Word of God. But you know what? Here's another thing that we need to focus on. We need to begin to see, because, you know, as he placed that Spirit inside these men right here, you know what, gave them the way to go, you know what, it was a thing that so many people sought after. They sought after that anointing, but they were filled with it. That's how you and I are today. We're filled with it. And you know what, as we're filled with the Spirit, as we've been saved by the grace of God through the blood of Jesus Christ, and filled with his Holy Spirit today to walk therein, you know what, there's a scripture that comes to my mind over in Luke, the 12th chapter, 48th verse. I'm going to paraphrase it right here a little bit. But it says, "Everyone to whom much is given, of him much be required." You know what? I'm going to tell you what. To say that God's been better than good to me would be an understatement. I can't get any better than that, but that's an understatement, how good God is. But as he's been good to me, it's been because he's blessed me with things that he entrusts me to use through the guidance of the Holy Spirit to benefit the kingdom of God. You know what? I'm going to tell you, as I'm thinking about this scenario right here, to everyone to whom much is given, God, if he's been good to you this morning, I know that he's given you so much. He's given you more than anybody else could give you. He's given you more than your mom and daddy, your grandma and granddaddy could ever give you. But of him shall much be required. He gives you and expects something in return. You know what I'm going to tell you? God loved us when we were in love. He loved us when we were out in sin. You know what, dabbling in the world? Even though he created us, even though he started it off from the very beginning, and a man continually grew evil and evil each and every day as the time passes on, and we get to where we are, but he still loved us enough that he sent his only begotten Son into the world, die on the cross, that if you and I would come unto him and accept him as our Lord and Savior, believe that he is the Son of God, we would have everlasting life. But I'm going to tell you right here, as he gives that, much is required. What's much? You know what, to me, I believe the Bible says that we're to give all. You know what? To be holy, it takes everything we've got. It takes our whole being trusting in God and allowing him to come in and change us and mold us into what he needs it to be. You know, God wasn't going to trust these men right here to go in and make this furniture any way they wanted to. He was not going to trust this man to go in, no matter how long he'd been a craftsman. And the Bible doesn't say, but I'm going to tell you right now, I think that he probably would have been pretty good at it. You know what? He wasn't slothful. He probably had some good attributes about it. You know, I'm not saying that God only calls those good attributes. You know what he called me, preacher? I ain't got no reason why to think why he would do that. But you know what? At the same time, what we begin to see right here is that whenever much is given, much is required. So you know what? The talents were given. Now he expects you to use them for the benefit. You know, when I think about that right there, so many times I think about those that have the ability to play music. You know what? I've got a lot of friends and family that are much more talented in music than I am. You know what? They got all the talent in the world, and you know what? It's a good thing. I'm glad God's given them that talent. But man, you look out there today and you see the things that they're doing with that talent. They're playing other kinds of music. They're playing in ungodly places. You know what? Not using that talent to where it could be used. And I'm gonna tell you, there's a lot of churches out there today that don't have piano players. Don't have guitar players. I don't have nothing to maybe uplift in the Lord's name. You know what? It ain't about the music so much as it is about the song. I know that. But you know what? To think about that, a talent that God gives. You know what? And our Father gives us things that we just don't use the way that He should. And you know what? I'm going to tell you, it's a desire of mine to be as He is. You know what? I'm going to tell you, that's not a bad thing. That's not something that you should not do. I know a lot of people are going to take that statement and probably run with it and probably say, well, he said he wants to be like God. No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is I want to be in the likeness of Him the way that He created me to be. Each and every man that's ever lived, walked this face of the earth, he expects you to live the way that He created you to be. But because of sinful nature, it led you away. But now, because of Jesus Christ, because His only begotten Son, if you would accept Him, now He can create you in a way, a more perfect way. He can add more detail to it. Now, you know what? The Spirit being filled within you today allows you to be that perfect man that He expected you to be from the very beginning. You know what? But we got to walk in the Spirit. For whom much is given. That Spirit of God, there is nothing in this world. There is not one thing that you know that is better, that is more powerful than the Spirit of God. And you know what? Not only does He give us that, though, I want to get into a couple things that He's given us right here. What our Heavenly Father has given us to be in the likeness of Him. And you know what? Two of the most powerful things. And I dare you to change my mind. Because the Bible tells me this, and that, you know what, we're going to get into Scripture here in a little bit. But not only do we have that indwelling of the Spirit, but the Bible also says that we've got something else. It says that we have the mind of Christ. You know what I'm thinking right here is that creation that God had set up, you know what I believe He foreordained it from the very beginning of time, from the very foundations of the world. God, that all-knowing God had predestined us to walk in this way, that would be after the likeness of His Son. And you know what it says right here? A lot of times, we have trouble with getting into deep thought about this. We have trouble a lot of times with understanding what the Word of God says. We have trouble sometimes with understanding why the things we do are wrong. You know what? Why are those troubles? And why are they facing us today? But you know what? With digging in and knowing that we have the Holy Spirit, we have the mind of Christ, these things can be settled. You know what? God intended on being that way. So we'll move over into 1 Corinthians, the 2nd chapter, 11th through the 16th verse, where we're going to read right here. It says, "For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God. Which things also we speak, not in words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolish unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he that is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ." You know, I'm going to tell you, I was reading that scripture right there, and I was like, well, I was thinking about this. I was like, hey, you know, this is some pretty in-depth, intense stuff right here. But you know what it says right here, and I'm going to go back and maybe backtrack on what this I begin to say. So, because there's a lot going on here. It says, "Even so, the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God." You know what? I believe we preached here a little while back about centering yourself in the center of God's will, how to find God's will. You know what? How to find God's will is a tricky thing if you're not looking the way that God expected you to look. You know what? We can go, it'd be like trying to put something together about the instructions. The Word of God instructs us to place ourselves in certain ways that we can receive God. And you know what? The only way that you can receive Him this morning is by Spirit. What did He tell the woman at the well? He told her that there would come a time where a man would have to worship Him in spirit and truth, because truly He is a spirit. You know what? So what we see right here is that that Spirit of God, the things which God of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. You know what? You're not going to know unless you've got that Spirit about you. So it goes on to say right here that we might know the things that are freely given to us. You know what? I'm going to tell you that everybody thought, well, hey, it's so hard to live. It's so hard to do things in the Bible. It's so hard to be a good Christian. Well, it's not that hard. And I've heard people say that time and time again. It's just a hard thing to do. No, it's not. It's not hard. If it's the very most important thing in your life, it's not that hard to do. You took the time to learn how to do your job, I'd say. I don't know what you do, but I'm going to tell you, one that would give themselves to their work is going to learn what to do. But I'm going to tell you what, it does take time. It takes experience. It takes a little bit of faith. But I'm going to tell you at the same time that you can learn. But learn of the Spirit. You can't learn the way that we're taught in schools to learn. You can't learn the way that you learn on the job to learn. You have to learn spiritually. You have to test. You have to try all things. You have to pray about stuff. You've got to get down to a time where you can be by yourself. You know, I think it's a lot of times where people fail and come short is they don't realize that there's got to be time to where it's just you and God to reach any further. Get down, because that's whenever the Spirit begins to move so mightily. And you know what? I've had some good times by myself. You know what? When the Lord gets about you, you get in that inner room and begin to pray to Him. You know, that's just special things, but that's for another time. But you know what? The things that are freely given to us. You know what? I was talking about how good God was, how He's good all the time. Everything He does is good. You know what? It's freely given. It's not that you can give back. God already gives it, knowing that you can't pay Him back. You know, how many people do you know that would give you something knowing that you couldn't pay them back? There's just but a handful. But God does it every time. But to know what it is, you know, and begin to know how to receive it. That which are things are also we speak in, and not in the words of man, that man wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Ghost teaches. You know what? That's a bad word right there. A lot of people don't like saying that, but it is the Holy Ghost. That Holy Spirit that dwells within you. You know what? If that Holy Ghost be about you today, and it'll teach you in all the ways, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. You know, I'm going to tell you, I believe that today is one thing we need to know. To know what that statement was a while ago that we talked about the woman at the well. What did he tell the woman at the well? To worship in spirit and truth, because God is a spirit. So at this point in time, we're trying to find out what it is to be a chip off the old block, how we can be like our Father. If our Father is a spirit, we need to be about the Spirit. We need to do things spiritually. We need to think to do each and everything, every aspect of our life needs to be done in a spiritual sense, not a fleshly sense. We left that. That dies out to us. That new creature is now taking over. We're now a son of God, an heir, if you would. So now, at that point in time, you don't live the same old way. It's a different kind of living. But I want to get down to what it says right here. As we see the Spirit right there is given to us. It dwells within us. It is a part of us. So we need it to be in the likeness of God. But it says, "For who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct them?" You know what? We're receiving instruction, but how can we do that? It says, but we have the mind of Christ. You know, I'm going to tell you right now is that there's one thing about it, is that Jesus, I believe he had a clear-cut focus on what the will of God was. Everything he done, you know, we can think about the story it tells about when he was 12-year-old, how he went missing. He couldn't find him, and finally they found him. And he was sitting in the middle of the doctors and lawyers right there and beginning to explain to them and teach to them and do things like that. And when they asked him, why he done it? Why would you give us that scare like that? Why would you run off like that? He said, must you know that I must be about my Father's business. You know, hey, how can we get to that point? Because I'm going to tell you right now, a lot of times I feel like we're running off almost the opposite direction. You know, how can we get to the point to where we are so mindful of leaving everything else out? You know what, I see people all the time, and you know what, I've been guilty myself, how we get so focused on all other things going on in life, like they actually matter. I'm not saying stop taking care of your family, and don't go to work or anything like that. That's not what I'm saying. But we get so caught up in everything else that we don't even consider that the things that we do may take us away from serving the Lord. We get so mindful about them, and we're worried about upsetting maybe our kids and our spouse and our family members and things like that because we don't go do certain things with them. And you know what? Instead of going to the house of God like it's expected to us. You know what, I've seen that happen, but that's not the only thing. But you know what, it happens quite a lot that way. And whenever one aspect of your life begins to slip, you can about say that a lot of other ones are too. Because it's not just one thing that a lot of times we're wrong, but it's multiple things. But the mind of Christ was set on God. Everything he thought about was doing the will of the Father. He didn't get caught up with what was going on in the other street over here from where he was teaching. He didn't get caught up with what festivities were going on. You know what? I see Christ going to a meeting and a lot of festivities, but they were all to do with the things that were holy in the Bible. You know what? The teachings of the old prophets and things like that. You know what? He was all about the Father's business. You know what, I like to say, I know that there's things that we do in life, things that God's given us to be able to enjoy. And I made mention earlier, I love to hunt and fish, and I love sports and things like that. But you know what, they're good in their time, but there's nothing to them. You know what, that's a hard thing to say because it's a big part of my life. But there is nothing of any content to those things. The only thing that's ever going to make a difference is what you do for the Lord. So, let's hone in and mold ourselves. And the only thing that we can do, once again, I'm not saying that you can make a change in yourself, is that to go into Jesus and ask him. But the thing that we can do today is to seek out and be more willing to be obedient. Seek out that you may find an altar somewhere and call out to him and ask him what you can do to make yourself in a way that be like unto him. Seek out a way that it might be more pleasing in his sight, the things you do. And there's one thing about it, I believe about every man, we're given but a certain time on this earth. And you know, it don't matter, yours might be longer than mine, it might be shorter than mine. But you know what, let's just take it on a day-to-day basis. You know, I mean, I don't know if we've really got the ability to even question, to bring that in, that we've got that, but I'm going to take a 24 hour. Each and every one of us got 24 hours in a day. You know what, there's no different for me and you any bit on that. We've got 24 hours in a day. But you know what the difference is on that is what we do with that 24 hours. What we do with that time we've been given. You know what? We can spend that time and be in mind and with the mindset that Christ had to be about the Father's business, to trust and let that Holy Spirit lead, guide, and direct. And everything that we do can be good. Or we can get about ourselves. And you know what? Those same opportunities are coming by and we're missing them. And God is placing them into others' hands. And you know what? Because God's work's still going to be done. Each and every time. At the end of the day, there's going to be a contrast that's going to take place. It's the same way. And when it comes to the time, whenever the Lord comes back, when God's had enough and he sends his son to go get his children, you know, there's going to be a time taking place to where it's going to be judged according to what a man done with the time that he had. You know what? And I'm going to tell you, his children, he's expecting them to have that ability about them to be in the likeness. Because I believe that God knows who's his. You know what? Jesus said, you know what? He was very clear on that. He said, my sheep know my name. I know my sheep. You know what? It's not word for word, but that's what he said. You know what? You're not going to get away with just trying to go about doing things and thinking that you can fool anybody because you can't fool God. God's going to know exactly who you are because you're going to look just like him. You're going to act just like him. You know what? I'm going to tell you, like I say, a lot of people try to shy away from that, but you know what? God has demanded that we be there. So you want to be a chip off the old block? You want to be accused of being like God? You need to follow after these things. Know that you are to be filled with the Spirit. Know that you're to have the mind of Christ. And those things right there, how can we do that? Well, now I've made this statement quite a lot, but once again, I believe in it. With the renewing of the heart comes a renewing of the mind. You know what? Christ, he has the ability to come in and change that heart. He takes that old stony heart, makes it give you a flesh, and one God can feel. And you know what? As he does that, he's able to work with it. He places the Spirit within you. And whenever he places that Spirit within you, it gives your mind a different way of thinking. It gives you a different way of going about doing things. And we're to set that mind, though, that we're given, that Christ-like mind, on the godly things, the goodly things, the things that are willing to please God. You know what? Not to think of anything else of the world, but to give ourselves over to that God may use that to accomplish what he needs to accomplish. You know what I'm going to tell you today? That's about all I've got for you. But in closing right here, you know what I want to challenge you? I want to challenge you to go out. And you know what I like to say? Good deeds, they're good. I mean, that's all there is to it. You know what? There's a lot of good things that can be done. We need to seek to do good things. But they're, once again, not enough. You must make sure that everything that you're about, inside and out, needs to be filled with that Spirit, everything that you do. And as you do that today, the good deeds that you do will not fall on the wayside. Will not go inconsequential. And you know what I'm thinking about this today. And a lot of good things are done, but what do they mount up to? Because when God does something, they mount up to something. You know, as he began to call these men out to build this furniture right here we just read about a while ago, they were to the accomplishment of something else. There was something taking place at that point in time that God's Spirit filled them up. And in every single moment, God was in it. And any time that God's in the moment, and any time we're in the midst of his presence, it's always a special thing. But it was the building up of something else. So to know today that we're a part of something much larger than ourselves, and each and everything that we do is for that building up today, that's a special time for a born-again child of God. So you know what? I want to encourage you today to seek out those things. Seek out those things that are good. And do them if you're led of the Spirit to do them. You know what? I believe you've got to be led. You've got to be God-sent to be able to do those things. And you know what? By searching out in prayer, I believe you'll be able to find it. So we're going to close out today, and that's all we've got for you. But we pray that the Lord bless you.
And I would be telling the truth. I can say I am worthless, a hopeless sinner, that's true. But that is just part of my story. I haven't told everything. I was lost, King from Jerusalem. I'm a part of the bloodline of David, that's who I am, and I claim kinship to Isaac, to Jacob, and Abraham. I'm a royal descendant.